a little bit of what we covered last time with this. So I'm just gonna we established who Proverbs is written by, God. Okay. And two, we have a mother in heaven, wisdom, who must also be the Holy Spirit. I do not understand why the Spirit is both appears and called a male, but there is no fourth person of God that we hear about. Neither do we read Father, Son, and Mother, or if God the Father is called a king, why we do not hear about a queen, except as I mentioned, possibly in Jeremiah 7 and 44. And I'm going to go over more of that in the future, and discuss some interesting facts about that. And then I talked about the transition in Proverbs 1:8 to 1:9, where the story of joining a band of murderous robbers is in fact an allegory. It is not about, generally people who are poring over the scripture are not going to join a band of murderous robbers. Therefore, that's not the issue. The issue is, it has to do with the default way, the way of the simple, who don't receive wisdom. And so now I'm going to move on here into what I want to talk about in this section. And so the first thing there is the manifestation of the difference in the Christian who finds the female person of wisdom. And as I established also before, wisdom is two parts: a thing, that is a knowledge set, as it might be obtained in a person, knowledge set and experience. So the first separation from the Christian who finds the female person of wisdom and the Christian who does not find any female person and says there's no female person and it's only just an allegory for wisdom as a knowledge set and there's no person involved. Okay, and that person is certainly not God and certainly not our mother. That's the position of the Christian who has not found wisdom, the person. But I say that the person who the man who has found wisdom will be able to fill the commandment to honor both our father and mother in heaven, and that is what the commandment to honor our father and mother means, because in the future, we may not be able to honor our father and mother, because I'm not going to be able to honor my father and mother in this life. They've both passed on, as a matter of fact. And so, if I've already done that, then you say, well, you've already done it, and how does it apply to, that's it. But the commandments appear to be something that has to do with forever. So, my feeling is that when it says father and mother, it means our father and mother in heaven, because what we read in Proverbs is that, and this is really important here, because see here, Proverbs 6:20, it says, "My son, keep thy father's commandment." Okay, father's commandment, that's ownership. Commandment. It can't be David. It can't be David's commandments. David can't say, "Keep thy father's commandments." Neither can Solomon, neither can any man. Only God can say, "My son, keep thy father's commandment," because the commandments don't belong to any earthly father, only the heavenly Father, God. And then it says, "Forsake not the law of thy mother." Now, whose mother has the law that is of her? See? So this is the law of our mother in heaven, and it says, "Forsake not the law of thy mother." So we know that this is Mother God. Okay? That's what I'm saying this is. And that when wisdom says in Proverbs 8:35, "For whoso findeth me findeth life and shall obtain favor of the Lord," What this means is that not everybody finds her. Okay? Many are called, but few are chosen. Whosoever finds me finds life. So if you haven't found her, you haven't found life. And this indicates that not everybody finds her. In fact, it seems to me if many are called but few are chosen, few find her, who is obviously a person. I mean, you can clearly see there's no chance that there's a misinterpretation that it's an allegory for a person, but wisdom is only just a knowledge set. I mean, you can see clearly. Then I was by him as one brought up with him, and I was daily his delight, rejoicing always before him. How can a knowledge set rejoice? Okay. Okay, so moving on. The man who finds wisdom, he turns from being simple. Okay, this is what I realized is what wisdom, our mother in heaven, is telling us who the simple are. And what simple means? Simple means that they have not found wisdom. They have not found her. They do not regard that they have a mother in heaven. And we can see that here also. Let's see, Proverbs 9, 4 through 6. Whoso is simple, let him turn in hither. As for him that wanteth understanding, she saith to him, Come, eat of my bread and drink of my wine, which I have mingled. Now this is really important stuff, because if you see here, this is the same mystery that Jesus was talking about, and I'm not claiming to understand it, but you can see here the same mystery. This is the same thing that Christ said, eat of my flesh, the bread, and then drink of this is my blood. This might be in part where Jesus came to understand what it was that he was going to teach with that parable and that saying, which the apostles said, this is a hard saying, Lord, who can understand it? Because they didn't understand why we would eat his flesh and drink his blood. And then but moving on, forsake the foolish and live and go in the way of understanding. You see, when you find wisdom, when you find the person, you change from being simple. And so when you become, you might say the opposite of that is complex, let's say it's complex, then you understand that we have a mother in heaven, then it's not just a father, it's the father and the mother in heaven. Now what all this means and the full details of it we don't know. But what I do know is that this female person here who we've established clearly must be God, is converting us from being simple. That's the main point I'm covering with this. And okay, and then next in the man who finds the female person of wisdom and who changes from being simple to wise, it says Proverbs 9:11. By her have his days multiplied. Okay, so in Proverbs 9:11 here, it says, For by me your days shall be multiplied, and the years of your life shall be increased. Now, I do not know what the mystery is of what these two things are, because it says your days shall be multiplied. This appears to be one thing, and then there's a second thing, and the years of your life shall be increased. And I'm not saying I understand what the meaning of those two things are, but I'm saying that clearly what this is saying is that if you remain simple and you say there's no female person of God, we have no mother in heaven, then you're not going to have your days multiplied and the years of your life increased. Okay, that's the point I'm making with this. This may mean, if nothing else, it means eternal life. It means that your days in the earth shall be forever, because you will bring honor to both your father and your mother, who are God. Behold, the tabernacle of God is among men. That's the conclusion of Scripture. And so we know that God is going to be a man in the earth, and there's no point in being a man, and there is no man without a woman, because what are you going to do there with your manhood? There's got to be a woman that's involved. Therefore, there must be, it makes sense that there would be an image of her. Now, if it turns out that there was no female person in heaven, then you might say, well, okay, the former format of the gods didn't have women, and so we were just these bisexual, sexless beings. But it does make sense that if he says father, that there would be a mother, and that God has hidden her on purpose, because if you acknowledge her, whoso findeth me findeth life, then you obtain life. And we can't have, infidels and unworthy people. See, we know that the unworthy are given the name. That's the importance of Matthew 7:21, is that we know that spirit-filled Christians in the end times say, Lord, Lord, because they can't say Lord, Lord of Jesus Christ unless they had received from the Holy Ghost the knowledge that he was Lord. So Dana was saying that in his book, he was pointing out to me that Matthew 7:21 means that it's actually non-Christians just kind of claiming to be Christians, trying to save their bacon, but they really weren't Christians the whole time. But that's not what the scripture says. The scripture says that you cannot call upon the name of Jesus Christ as the Savior, and the propitiation for your sin, and the name of salvation given among men, unless that knowledge is given by the Holy Spirit into your mind. So we know then, and also the story of the 10 virgins, the five that were wise that brought the oil, and the five that were not wise, and they bang on the door saying, Lord, Lord, open up to us again. That means that there are those who are going to say to God, hey, we're Christians, open up to us. How come, Lord, we're not let in? We're Christians. And he's going to say, I never knew you. Be away from me, you workers of iniquity, because they did not live worthy. They did not make themselves holy. So we know that then that there's going to be many that are Christians that were given even gifts of the Holy Spirit to heal and to throw out demons and all kinds of wonderful works, as is written in Matthew 7:21. But what happens somehow? They continue in iniquity, because Jesus says that, be away from me, I never knew you, you workers of iniquity. And then a correspondence, though, with that is that these Christians should also not know wisdom, because if they know wisdom, whosoever findeth me findeth life. Okay? So we know that only those who have found life find our mother in heaven. The rest say, nope, we've got no mother in heaven, even though that's what it says in Proverbs, and it can't be anybody else but God, but I'm going to deny all that, not see any of it. And it's I realize I could argue with my friend all I want, and he will never never say that we have a mother in heaven. He'll say, nope, that's a strange doctrine, that's not what the scripture says. And I'm never going to convince him. I hope, I pray for him that he will, because I think that when you find wisdom, you find life, and that's what it means. When you obtain favor of the Lord, it's from finding wisdom. Okay. Now let's and moving on here. So the man who finds wisdom, he knows that the law is of his mother, and that they are chains about his neck. Now, what all this means, in particular, I'm not going to say I understand. But what we do know is that, the saved Christian is going to have restraints on him that that others may not. And so the chains are probably what, you know, saves him from hell, because he makes himself holy through obedience to the law. And what I would contend is that the simple cannot be obedient to the law, and that's what the Proverbs starting in 1:9 really means, the joining the band of robbers. Because what happens is, when you remain simple, you don't notice that the world's occupations are wickedness. And that's what I'm starting to talk about here, 1:10 through 1:19, when she says, "Do not consent to the default, which is without wisdom, foolishness equals minus wisdom, which is being greedy of gain." See, I think that when it says here in Proverbs 1:19, when it says, "So are the ways of everyone that is greedy of gain," see, this is the conclusion of the shedding of blood, the whole story of the robbers, and she's warning about this. But it's an allegory for what happens to people, and the conclusion of that allegory for those who continue in the default sin of the world is that they become greedy of gain. Even though they may be poor, that doesn't make any difference. They become greedy of gain, and it takes away their life. So, and then next, the man who finds the person of wisdom and will honor his mother in heaven avoids the destruction, fear, and desolation of being simple, and turning away from our sister, our kinswoman, wisdom. The scripture says to call her our sister and our kinswoman. And the destruction of the prosperity of fools. Okay, so in Proverbs 1:24, you see, this is the part where she's, "I have called and you refused. I have stretched out my hand and no man regarded." See, what's happening here, when we don't receive wisdom, is that we don't know that we're being rebuked. And that's what I see is the important thing about this, is the recognition that we're being rebuked. And what I would really be cautious to say most clearly is that what seems wrong to us is actually justice, and we become angry. I notice I become angry at that rebuke, and that we do tend to despise the rebuke because we don't understand why suddenly we're afflicted, why suddenly the pain that seems to be like there was no warning, all of a sudden, bam, and now we're permanently afflicted, or bam, now we're, you know, we have an injury, or bam, we lost our money or something, and there's that pain, and it seems, and there's like there's a tendency. But I think it's part of the test of the soul, because our spirits are set against justice. God is just. So we perceive as wrong that which is actually right. And when we receive wisdom, when we honor our mother in heaven, when we acknowledge her, when we find her, then we are able to realize that we are being rebuked. That's what I realized when those calamities would come in my life, that you are being rebuked. And what I would contend is that we really may not understand this until we have found favor with the Lord by finding our mother in heaven and honoring her, because that's the commandment, to honor our father and our mother. Our mother is the Holy Spirit, the right hand of God. That's what I believe the scripture is clearly saying. But again, it's a matter of choice. You know, people are going to believe as they've been given to believe, and the heart, you know, the heart guides the path of a man, but the Lord guides his footsteps. Therefore, how can a man know his own way? It's all a grand mystery. But it's required to be a mystery, otherwise we couldn't walk in faith. Continuing with the Proverbs 1:24 through through 32 avoids the destruction and the fear and desolation of being simple and turning away from sister wisdom. I want to also just talk about here the prosperity of fools. You see, this is the prosperity that comes when, as a fool, because the fool is when you turn away from wisdom. So that the fool is the default of not having wisdom. So if you haven't found the me, who is our mother wisdom, you remain a fool. And but the prosperity of fools shall destroy them. And that's the iniquity that God is talking about, because whether you're godly and a Christian and praying and shouting and doing all these great things in the church and so forth, but you don't have wisdom, then you'll have a prosperity of being a fool, and it shall destroy you. This the prosperity of fools matches the ends here of so are the ways of everyone that is greedy of gain. The greedy of gain, again, you don't have to be a rich man in order to be greedy. You can have, just about nothing and just be like a, whatever, a pilgrim or something like that. Just got your Bible and a wooden table in your little house or whatever. But you could still be greedy of gain because you have not listened to the voice of wisdom. You haven't understood that she's crying without. The without means without the church, in my opinion. Outside. She's outside, not in the church. She utters her voice in the streets. That means without the outside the church, because it's because she's not in the churches of this world, in this current world. And I don't mean the churches that were with Paul in his day. I think that that's why it says now she is without, when it further talks about. Let's see, it's in here in. Wisdom 8:1. Does not wisdom cry and understanding put forth her voice? She stand at the top of the high places. That wasn't the now. I was looking for the, there's a place where it says she is without now. Okay, but moving on. In Proverbs 1:33, it says that the man who finds wisdom will dwell safely and be quiet from the fear of evil. So let's look at that, because I mean, who else can you hearken to and think that you're going to be safe from all evil? It can only mean God. Okay, so here we are in Proverbs 1:33, and it says, "Whoso hearken," that means obey and stick to, as a master, "whoso obeys and sticks to me shall dwell safely." Okay, and shall be quiet from the fear of evil. And this me is still the female person who laughs, you see. Wisdom cries without. She utters her voice in the streets. This is still wisdom talking, and she's saying, "Whoso hearkeneth unto me shall dwell safely and shall be quiet from fear of evil." So what I would contend is that the man who has not found her, our mother in heaven, wisdom, is not going to dwell safely and is not going to be quiet from the fear of evil. The fear of evil is going to lurk in on them. They're gonna be afraid of evil coming. And that's the sign of the simple who have not found our mother in heaven, wisdom. Also, that we call her our sister, our kinswoman, is what the scripture says for us to do. By seeking her, Proverbs 2, 4, and 5, we understand the fear of the Lord and find the knowledge of God. Okay, so in Proverbs 2, 4, and 5, "If thou seekest her as silver and searchest for her as hid treasures, then shall thou understand the fear of the Lord and find the knowledge of God." So the man who will acknowledge his mother in heaven, and that we have a mother in heaven, and that there is a female person of God, even though we don't know why she appears as a he at times. Who knows? Maybe she's bisexual, but and that's something have to do with the gods. I don't know. I'm only speculating. But what I'm pointing out is that it makes sense that we have a mother and that we honor her, and that it has to be the Holy Spirit, and that the knowledge that's come into me about this is that it is God. So what I would point out is the man who has found wisdom and acknowledges the female person of wisdom, and that we and that the law is of our mother in heaven, he shall understand the fear of the Lord and find the knowledge of God. And the man who does not will not understand the fear of the Lord and not find the knowledge of God. And that's pretty clearly the hallmark of someone who is not saved. And so, and the next point is that he gets sound wisdom by the Lord. He keeps the paths of judgment and preserves the way, and gives to him discretion and understanding. Which is needed to keep him from the way of the evil man. And this is the part here in Proverbs 2. Then shalt thou understand righteousness and judgment and equity in every good path. When wisdom enters into your heart and knowledge is pleasant to your soul, discretion shall preserve thee, and understanding shall keep thee, to deliver thee from the way of the evil man, Satan. See? And then it says, and then it's also says the woman. And notice how it's to deliver thee from the strange woman. So you have the evil man and you have the strange woman. This is your enemy, the couple, the man and the woman that are the leaders of those who lead your soul into hell, the devils. And so it means that we have two leader figures, enemies, and let's not forget the strange woman, who I believe is the daughter of Babylon. So continuing though here in Proverbs 2, and this is the other thing that I'm going to point out here, is that what this is saying here is that no man survives without wisdom. And it says, if you will receive my words and hide my commandments with thee, so that thou incline thy ear unto wisdom, and incline thy heart to understanding, if thou criest after knowledge, and liftest up thy voice for understanding, if you seek her as silver, and search for her as hid treasures, then shalt thou understand the fear of the Lord. And then the rest of it was talking about what happens if you don't. To deliver thee from the way of the evil man and the evil woman. And then here in Proverbs 2:21 and 22, for the upright shall dwell in the land, and the perfect shall remain in it. See, this is what this matches what the commandment to honor your father and mother says. Because it says, okay, so we're here in Exodus 20, 12, and it says, honor thy father and thy mother, that thy days may be long upon the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee. And that's, people say, well, that's with promise. Well, promise for what? It's if you don't honor both your father and your mother, your days will not be long upon the land. That's really what this is saying. That to me is more clearly what this is saying. It's saying that you will bring your honor unto your father and your mother, that you may live, if you want to live forever upon the earth. If you don't want to live forever, then just don't honor your father and mother, and you'll be cut off, as it is written here, as it says here, Proverbs 2:21 and 22, for the upright shall dwell in the land, and the perfect shall remain in it, but the wicked shall be cut off from the earth, and the transgressors shall be rooted out of it. So just remember what it said in the beginning here, that if you cry after knowledge, if thou seeketh her as silver and search for her as for hid treasures, and we know from the rest of Proverbs, there's definitely a person involved with wisdom. Yes, it's a knowledge set, and wisdom is spoken of as a thing and a knowledge set. However, it is also spoken of as a person. So that means what? It's two things. She's two things. And it says, the upright shall dwell in the land, and the perfect shall remain in it. So what that's saying is, if you're not upright, you won't dwell in the land, and if you're not perfect, you won't remain in it, because the wicked shall be cut off. See, what this is kind of the either or, what I'm talking about, the joining the band of robbers. Because if you're simple and you don't acknowledge your mother in heaven, you say, nope, we don't have no mother in heaven, I'm not going to listen to what Proverbs clearly says. That book was mistranslated or something. We know the Holy Spirit is male, and we have no mother in heaven, and there's no female figure, and man is not made God is not in the image of woman, and we're not going to have to accept that a woman is the image of God. I'm not going to accept any of that. This is what will happen to you. The wicked. You'll become the wicked, and you'll be cut off from the earth. That's what I say. And the man who acknowledges wisdom and finds wisdom and knows we have a mother in heaven, and gives her honor, he will have length of days, one, riches, and honor. So let's take a look at Proverbs 3:16. Length of days is in her right hand, and in her left hand riches and honor. See, this is a person, and what this means is that living forever goes hand in hand with honoring wisdom. Here in Proverbs 3:17, the man who acknowledges wisdom will have ways of pleasantness and paths of peace. You see, if you don't have her, you're not going to have her ways and her ways of pleasantness and peace. So you're not going to have pleasantness, and you're not going to have peace. And, you know, she is a tree of life to them that lay hold upon her, and happy is everyone that retaineth her. And Proverbs 3:23, the man who acknowledges wisdom shall walk safely, and his foot shall not stumble. So if you don't have wisdom, the female person of wisdom, and you haven't acknowledged her, then you're not going to walk safely, and your foot's going to stumble. That's what this is saying. It's an either or. Everything is an either or generally is an either or. It's either an either or it's both. And then in Proverbs 4:7, it says, wisdom is the principal thing, therefore get wisdom, and with all thy getting, get understanding. See, that if it says wisdom is the principal thing, yes, it's the thing, therefore get wisdom. But that comes with, I believe, acknowledging the person. And there is no one without the other. And then we know that if you exalt her, she will promote you. I mean, are you going to get promoted if you don't exalt her and also realize that it's a person? You won't get promoted. and you won't and she gives to the head of those who will honor her and embrace her an ornament of grace, a crown of glory shall she deliver to thee. And the years of your life shall be many. See, this again matches the commandment to honor your father and mother, because your days in the land will not be long if you don't honor your mother, because it says, and the years of your life shall be many. Well, if you don't, then what? You won't, the years of your life will not be many. You have to see what it's saying you're not getting if you don't. And a lot of people are a little bit too positive about everything to realize that this is it's a dire situation. We're not told that you can take God, and if you don't, well, okay, that's your choice. No, it's bad news altogether, very bad news if you refuse your Creator. So it's one or the other. It's heaven or hell. That's why, the scripture doesn't say that something else happens to you when you die. It is given to man to die once and then the judgment. And judgment infers one or the other, heaven or hell. There's no other, some people, they did a good report recently. There's no purgatory. Purgatory is not in scripture. So there's no redemptive, some partial place. And, it's one or the other. It's heaven or hell.